To that, the pulpit committee will be bringing a special announcement on Sunday as well that you won't want to miss. And the message on Sunday is going to be, it's time to dream. And we're going to look at the life of Philip the evangelist. And I know that you're going to be challenged about dreaming more about what God would have you to be doing for him. As we enter into this important time, and I can't give away what the board or what the pulpit committee will be saying on Sunday, but I would like to encourage you to sign this list of 30 days of prayer and fasting, and to take a day in which you would be willing to just say, yes, I will put my name on that, and I will take the time to pray on a specific day. We want to cover the whole month as we are right now diving into this pastoral search. And if you feel led to fast, fast. If you don't, you don't need to fast. But we just want to have a focused time of prayer and fasting over these next 30 days. Well, Cindy, would you help me tonight? Because I was given instruction on how to take the offering, the BGMC offering, and you know, you and I have been the recipients of BGM funds, and for 30 years, we, yes, I know. Do you remember some of the things that BGMC allowed you to do?
Would you like me to take the whole evening? Because it could be very long. Yeah, BGMC blessed us over and over and over again in Chinese, in China, buying puppets, duffel bags full of puppets, duffel bags full of Betty, Luke, and flannel graphs. I know that may sound a little old school, but it crosses over culturally very well. My ventriloquism doll was BGMC, just lots of stuff.
And I think you had some printing projects.
Oh yeah, last 7 years was translating the Assembly of God youth curriculum into Chinese, which was legally published, printed and published in China.
So we love BGMC, and we can tell you boys and girls, those monies that you give to help the missionaries with BGMC go a long, long way in helping children around the world know that Jesus loves them. So thank you so much for your giving. Well, if you can, I need you to hold that so we don't know which way it's going to go to the very end. And I don't know what, do we sing anything or say anything, or do we just let it happen? Okay, let's let it happen. Come give your coins to BGMC. Have the children come and get the coins? Oh, you have to choose which color. So how do you do that? So, yeah, girls, are you okay with yellow? You don't want the blue? Okay, boys are blue, girls are yellow. Okay, I'll give the countdown. If that's anybody else. Oh, one more. No, one more. Okay, we'll do a countdown. Wow. Where does this money keep coming from? Oh! Congratulations, boys. Is there anyone here tonight that is studying Chinese? Are you really? Oh, well, I think, let's talk and see if they can understand our Chinese. Do you have a mic?
No, we'll share.
Okay. 小姐,我想你是一个漂亮的女人。
John Davis, stop being yourself.
You're supposed to be only speaking in Chinese. 你好吗?
很好,谢谢。
你叫什么名字?
我叫Cindy。
Cindy, 你是从什么地方来的?
我从美国来。
Oh, 你从美国来。 Did you understand any of that?
No!
Okay, I think we can let the kids go, is that right? Have a great time, kids. Thank you for your giving. Well, some of you may have got the e-bulletin. And that is beginning tonight, just looking at what do healthy churches do. And we're expecting your participation. Many of you have been involved with church life for a long, long time. And will be able to give us some insight into, from your perspective, what you sense the healthy church is. Of course, we'll be looking at God's Word tonight as well in Acts chapter 2. But I'd also like to start something special on Wednesday. We have met so many wonderful people here at the Sandy Church, and we really haven't got to know you very well, and I just thought it would be fun to take 5 minutes each Wednesday night to have someone share their story of how they came to know Jesus. And so we're going to ask Cindy to come and share her story, 5 minutes, and to just give you kind of an example of what we're looking for. And we've asked Barbara if she would share next week, but I'm looking for volunteers, and then I'll just recruit you that would be willing to share their testimony. Are you ready?
Okay. So I grew up in the Bay Area of Santa Rosa, California, and I lived there until I was about 12 years old. I didn't grow up in a Christian home. It was the 60s, and my older brothers and sisters kind of got involved with the LSD movement, the hippie movement. It's close by, kind of started in the, you know, Haight-Ashbury, San Francisco. So they were influenced that way. As a young girl in lower elementary, I have memories of going to Catholic Mass once in a while. You know, I have a sweet memory of seeing my mom tear up during a song at Catholic Mass. And that really kind of touched, you know, it's just this memory I have. But then she just kind of started to dabble into some belief systems that had a much darker side. What I would think of as New Age, following Middle Eastern gurus, and she had the posters on the wall and would meditate in front of them. And memories of my dad confronting her twice about demonic activity in the home. Now, he's not a Christian, but he has enough sense about him to know she's involved with something very, very dark. And those are just kind of like, oh, my dad's talking to my mom about the stuff happening, music coming out of the bed, and another time when he was being held down in his bed and couldn't physically get up. And he didn't appreciate it. He didn't like it. And then My brothers and my older sister, you know, kind of got involved with drugs and all the trappings that are involved with that. You know, memory of the police calling because my brother was down at the jail. And then at 12, we moved up to Cottage Grove, Oregon, just below Eugene. And there, on a Saturday morning, I'm watching cartoons. I'm sure it was Scooby-Doo, right? We were all watching Scooby-Doo. And there's a knock on my door. And it's a man from the local Assembly of God Church, just in little Cottage Grove, Oregon. And he's inviting me to ride a Sunday school bus to go to church the next morning. Well, he's this tall, and I was embarrassed to say no, so I just agreed to go to church. And so I climbed up on that Sunday school bus. I remember that first Sunday sitting in a circle. The Sunday school lesson was so boring to me, but the boys were throwing spit wads at each other with these plastic spoons, and that kind of entertained me. And then every Saturday morning afterwards, there was a knock at my door inviting me to go to church. Sometimes I said yes, sometimes I ran out the back door and let somebody else answer that door. But little by little, I started going to this church faithfully. That spring, Lincoln Middle School, that I was a part of, had an afternoon assembly, like a school assembly. And then after the assembly, they invited everyone to attend an evening event that was obviously an outreach event at the local high school. So some of the kids at the church were telling me, you know, they were going, can we pick you up and take you? So I went. That evening is just kind of a permanent image in my mind. Six rows back, left side of the theater auditorium, the aisle seat. And I can't remember what the man spoke of that night, but I remember the feeling when he gave the call for salvation. Because it was like I physically could not sit in my seat. I just was propelled out of that seat like a cannon and went down front and stood there with about 30 other teenagers being led through the sinner's prayer. And then a lady by the name of Lena Harris put her arm around me. She's from the little church that I was going to. And she walked me up the steps of the platform of that theater, pulled back this big heavy velvet curtain, and we sat in the backstage as she just kind of opened up this little pamphlet and walked me through the story of how beautiful Christ's love was for me and prayed with me. So I rode that Sunday school bus all the way through middle school and high school. 6 years, you know, and I was different than the other kids. You know, mom and dad didn't bring me to church. I was coming alone on that Sunday school bus. But I just think of the faithfulness of those people who probably thought they were just doing ordinary, boring ministry, picking me up every Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Wednesday night youth group. But their faithfulness to do what felt ordinary transformed my life. And I was the first Christian in my home, and I'm happy to tell you now all five of my brothers and sisters and both of my parents, they have all come to know the Lord and have wonderful, vibrant relationships with the Lord. And I did it without crying. Yay.
And it was just a few years after that that Cindy proposed to me. At least I'd like to think it was that way. Isn't that a wonderful testimony of God's goodness and His love? And just as we share how God uses people to bring us to a place of knowing Him, it stirs our faith. And as we listen to these testimonies, I pray that God stirs our hearts and says, you know, it wasn't that hard for Cindy to come into the kingdom. Maybe my neighbor can be one like that too. Maybe the kids that are running around with my kids could be brought to church too. It just gives us that added desire to see those around us have an opportunity to come to faith, to know the Lord. Well, we're looking tonight at what do healthy churches do? And I saw my name up there. This was actually put together by a friend of ours, this study, named David Dykes. David pastors the Green Acres Baptist Church in Tyler, Texas. And he was visiting with us in Beijing, and he was sharing with us some of these principles. And I said, David, you should put that in a book. And guess what? He did. And that's been printed in several different languages, and it's a wonderful study and really just draws us right into the scripture. So the question tonight is, why do you think healthy churches matter? Or another way to say it, why is it important to have healthy churches? Anyone want to respond to that? Why is it important for us to have healthy churches? So little girls that are not from a healthy spiritual family at least have a chance. That's good. Anyone else? Why is it important to have healthy churches? Michael. As a witness to the world. Amen. Well, let me give you just a few things that came to my mind. The local church, as Bill Hybels has said, is the hope of the world. The local churches enable followers of Jesus to stay strong. The local church is a witness to God's goodness in the local community, what Michael just shared. The local church provides salt and light. The local church can help others come to know Jesus and eternal life. God uses the local church to bring glory to himself. It has been said, every church should have at the very center of its core values a desire to grow, renew itself, and expand to include as many possible in the kingdom. So we might say it's an organism that is growing and renewing and expanding. And as a newcomer among you coming here to Sandy, I can't tell you how excited Cindy and I have been in seeing how healthy your church is. You have a healthy church. So tonight, I'd like us to begin exploring what healthy churches do. And I really want you to help me, for you to give your own observations as you've experienced church about what you see as helping a church be healthy. And even if you see things that are leading a church away from being healthy, to help us understand that too. So as we look at this question, what do healthy churches do? Our best reference for answering this question is really found in the Bible, in this great passage that we find in Acts chapter 2 and verses 47. And let's just read this together. And wouldn't it be fun to try to actually read this out loud? This is the ESV version. So let's start with verse 42, and let's go ahead and read this out loud. Let me get that off of there. Okay. Yes, Acts chapter 2, starting with verse 42. Here we go. And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and prayers. And awe came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. And all who believed were together and had all things in common. And they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as any had need. And day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to their number day by day those who were to be saved. So as we look at this study from this passage, our friend David has listed five things that he feels a healthy church should do. And Ron, let's go ahead and put those up. And these are the five things he lists. Offer consistent Bible teaching and preaching. Build community. Make prayer the priority. Trust God to do the supernatural things, and maintaining unity. So looking again at our text, and those of you that have your Bibles open, and if you didn't bring your own Bible, I know that the Bible there in the pew is the exact text that we just read tonight, so you could open that up and look. What I'd like us to do is to just ask ourselves as we look at these points, what made the author pick these specific thing. So looking at number one, offer consistent Bible teaching and preaching, is there any biblical support for that in this text that we just read? Devoting themselves to what?
To God's work. To the word.
To the apostles' teaching.
That's the word.
I thought you were a licensed minister. Just joking, Steve. So they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. Number two, build community. Is there anything there that implies that a healthy church is involved with creating community? Fellowship. I think we see the word together a few times. Breaking bread. They were at the temple and they were also together in their homes. They were sharing their resources with each other. Any other thought from that text that would speak of community? They were praying together. So when we look at point three, make prayer the priority, we see there in verse 42, and they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, to the breaking of bread. And in the ESV it says, and the prayers. And in several other translations it says, and to prayer. And of course, as you read on through the New Testament, we see again and again this focus on the importance and priority of prayer. Now, why would we have number four, trust God to do supernatural things? Is there any evidence in the healthy church, this beginning church, of believing God for supernatural things? Right, right there in verse 43. And awe came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs are being done through the apostles. And then the last point there, what do healthy churches do? Maintain unity. And as you see how that throughout that text, they are coming together for prayer, they're coming together for breaking bread, they're coming together as they devote themselves to the teaching of the apostles. Day by day, they are again at the temple together in verse 46 and breaking bread in their homes. They receive their food with glad and generous hearts and praising God and having favor with all of the people. And so we see from that text there in Acts 2:42. Through 47, that sense of unity there as well. So as you look at that list, is there anything that feels like it's missing? That if, you know, as you are thinking about what it is to be a healthy church, is there anything there that feels like it's missing?
Outreach.
Yeah, it doesn't really list evangelism, does it? Yeah, I guess you could say there in verse 47, the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved, and they were probably bringing their friends into that community activity that was going on, but we don't see anything specific that's speaking about sending forth into missions, although as you continue to read the book of Acts, of course, that that is there. So, tonight, I want to specifically focus on this thought of offer consistent Bible teaching and preaching. Offer consistent Bible teaching and preaching. Cindy and I had a rather unpleasant experience shortly after arriving in Portland, not quite 3 years ago. And we are, you know, with the house churches in China, where there's not often proper training for pastors, it's not uncommon for there to be false teachings within the house church. And just with the lack of training, and sometimes just simply a lack of exposure to God's word within the Chinese church, especially in the countryside, things can get a little bit strange. But when we found in one of our churches in Portland a divergent teaching, it really caught us off guard. And you could see outside that it was an Assemblies of God church, but as we went inside, there was no sign of the Bible. And as they began their service, every person in the place literally had the book of a friar, a Catholic minister who's, I believe, been defrocked even by the Catholic Church. And they were going through his book like it was the Bible. And we began, as we listened, and we went several times just to kind of get a sense of what was happening in this church, it was obviously that the Bible had been set aside, and they had taken instead the teachings of a man, and the pastor and his wife had actually led the whole group astray into this strange and divergent understanding of truth. Fortunately, the man spoke with the Oregon Ministry Network leadership. He said, "I realize I'm not teaching the fundamentals of truth according to the Assemblies of God, and I realize that I need to resign and I can no longer keep my place." And so he left, and the church is now two services a Sunday with a vibrant fellowship led by a new American, a Slavic speaking pastor who also preaches in English, and that building is being used for God's glory. So what happened there? At some point, the church became unhealthy because they left having consistent, faithful Bible teaching and preaching. And that's really at the heart of a healthy church, is if you go into a healthy church, one of the first things you'll discover is God's word is there. And when you begin to be engaged and someone is up on the platform speaking, and there's no sign of God's word being shared or preached from, that's a sign of a very unhealthy church. And so you hear, I know from Pastor Jeremy and just this short amount of time that we've been with you, you love the preaching and teaching of God's word. And if someone just gets up and shares stories, I think you'd probably get up and walk out. I hope you would. At least you'd chastise the guy afterwards and say, "Hey, wait a minute, we didn't even hear from God's word today." So this first thought of a sign of a healthy church, what do healthy churches do? They offer consistent Bible teaching and preaching. Anyone have a thought or a word they'd like to share about that? Remember, you're supposed to help me tonight.
When we went into Prescott, which was our first mission field, there were, I think, about 12 people there on that first day that we arrived. And one of the things that I noticed was how excited they were to have a pastor there. And that was the very first thing. After we talked for just a very short time, there was a knock at the back door, and somebody was trying to come in. "Can I come in?" And so we had her come on in. And, you know, one thing that we talked about is, wouldn't it be something to have a church where everybody broke through their fear and welcomed somebody to the church on that day? If you broke through that fear that you have to reach out to somebody else, a stranger, and you begin to make a habit of reaching out to other people, wouldn't that be a place where people would like to come, where they felt special when they got there? And I think then the second thing is, not the second thing, but the key was, I used the gospel of Jesus Christ in the simplest form with them on my first, probably a year there. And the difference that made was amazing. The beauty of it was that the people began to welcome everybody that came through the door, because they knew that the gospel was going to be preached, and they wanted to be a part of loving on somebody else new.
So I think that's one good way to start. And if you have a hard time reaching out to somebody else, and it's really hard to do, it's probably hard to a lot of you to start out. But if you break through that and you reach somebody and encourage them and sit down and get to know them and talk to them, things are going to change in your church. And they're going to say, everybody loves me in that place. I like to go there because everybody likes me in that place. And don't you feel that way here? We did. That's why we're here. And it didn't take us long to find out that we like to be in a place where people love each other. So that was a blessing, and that's why Barbara and I are sitting here today.
Thank you, Steve. Rich.
Consistency is great, but I think it's some churches take scripture out of context. So I think ministering the word of God in its entirety, you know, the whole counsel of God. There's a pastor that I know, and you all know, that always said, read 10 scriptures before, verses before and 10 after. It gives you the context of what that scripture is talking about. So I think that should be included in that as well.
Yeah, excellent. And that is certainly true. It's been said you can argue anything from the Bible. It just depends on which verse you take and how that you take it. So being consistent, not just pulling a verse here and a verse there, but being able to use the whole counsel of the scripture in presenting those truths. Any other thoughts before I walk through three things that I think are reasons why we should have consistent Bible teaching? Yes, Seth.
Well, Ann and I have been here just past 10 years. And we came out of another local church, Foursquare. We'd been in Foursquare churches all of our lives, but I think the churches that we were in tended to wander from Scripture. And we never or very rarely heard a gospel presentation for years. And so when we showed up to the Assembly of God, I remember the first Sunday, he shared the gospel, you know, pretty openly, pretty clearly. And that was great. I hadn't heard it for a long time. And then we come back the next Sunday. He kind of interweaves the gospel in the message. Well, okay, another time. 4 or 5 weeks in a row, I hear the gospel. And I'm thinking, can we kind of get on to something else? And then the Lord, just as I've been here for 10 years, the believers need to hear the gospel very often. And Sundays, not too much.
Yeah.
So.
Amen. A place where the gospel is preached. And you know, right now we are passing around that clipboard for those of us that would like to join in supporting prayer for your new pastor. He's out there, or she's out there somewhere. And we, you know, as we Monday, I just need to be very careful. I can't say what the pulpit committee needs to say to you. But as we enter into this very special season, wouldn't it be great if we would be praying that God would send a pastor that would be focused on preaching and teaching the Bible? We don't want a self-help guy. We don't want a little bit of scripture and then a lot of his thoughts and theory. We want someone that's standing firmly on God's word, and that through the Holy Spirit, what we hear Sunday after Sunday is just solid Bible teaching of God's word. And that's what we need to be praying for. And that's what we need to be asking the Lord for. Well, three quick thoughts on why consistent Bible teaching and preaching is important. And the first one is this: we find the answers to life's biggest questions in God's word. People throughout the world and every culture long for answers to their most heartfelt concerns. And this is certainly true with the Chinese. Why am I here? What is my purpose in life? Where did I come from? Where am I going? Through consistent Bible teaching and preaching, we can reveal the answers to them and provide the opportunity for God to change their lives for eternity. In John 6:68, Simon Peter answered him, "Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. And of course, as we are here tonight as followers of Jesus, we know that apart from him, there is no answer. That the longer we serve him, the more we have the deepest questions and needs of our being satisfied and met. So we find the answers of life's biggest questions in God's word. Any thought or input on that? That stir anything? Yes.
So I went on a 10-day trip just recently with my senior, and we had some conflicts because it was anytime you have a group of people, you have conflicts. And they were just resolved by going to the Word, by like submerging in the Word, and then, you know, being able to look at the feelings that were hurt or different things and just go to the Word and then just have a devotion time like the next morning or whatever. And it's just so healing. When you speak his words, there's no pride, it's not yourself, you're not, you know, it's not all the things that you think you should say, or you want to tell them what they should be doing, right? You just go to his word, and you're right, all the answers were there every single time, and it was just amazing. Yeah.
Thank you, and what was your name? Thank you, Deanna. What a beautiful testimony of the power of God's words to just pinpoint exactly those questions that come to us. Any other thought on God's word answering those questions that people are really searching for answers to? Can we find in the word whether or not we should be supporting the ducks or the beavers?
Quack, quack. No, it's that God made us, so he knows us intimately, and so he knows exactly what we need, you know? So it's like he answers every question that we would have because he knows us.
And that is so true, because he's our creator, he's manufactured us, and he's given us the owner's manual so that we know exactly what we need to take care of what he has made. Yeah, that's a beautiful thought, and I can be naughty sometimes. I'm sorry I brought that up about the other. Number two, we find the sole source of authority for our lives in God's Word. Why should we have consistent Bible teaching and preaching? Because it is the sole source. Get that. It is the sole source of authority for our lives in God's Word. In today's society, truth is considered relative. The world says, what is true for you may not be true for me. Non-believers doubt whether any one true, infallible authority exists. However, the Bible presents itself as the basis of all authority because it explains God's love and his laws. We never have to wonder what God expects of us because it is written plainly in the Bible. The Bible is not a human idea. It is God-inspired. Peter explained it this way, for prophecy never had its origin in the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. 2 Peter 1:21. Cindy, you have studied a little bit about the relative truth. Your truth may not be my truth, but could you give that illustration about the gasoline and the juice?
This is from Lee Strobel. So, you know, really relative truth usually gets applied just to our belief systems. In the physical world, emotional world, we don't say, you know, okay, it's true for you, but it's not true for me. We don't really do that in the physical world. You wouldn't say, oh no, the car isn't barreling down the highway. You can go ahead and walk across it. Just say to yourself, the car's not there. So Lee Strobel gives an illustration. You wouldn't pour yourself a glass of gasoline and look at it and say, it's orange juice. I believe it's orange juice, and drink it. Or put the orange juice in your car and say, I believe it's gasoline. I just believe it with all my heart. It just comes down to this when we're talking about belief systems that people want to walk, you know, this road of relative truth. In the physical world, it doesn't work. In the emotional world, it doesn't work. In the spiritual world, it doesn't work either. But is that it? Okay.
So we live in a world that has bought into this lie, and that is, it's okay for you to have your truth and for me to have my truth. That you know, there is truth, and of course God's word tells us that Jesus himself, well, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And for us that are followers of Jesus, if you have Jesus, you have truth. If you do not have Jesus, you've not yet met truth. And looking at this world of relativity, how everything relative, when we come back down to this book right here, we're able to say, this is the final guide and rule and authority. And if this book says it's this way, then that's what we believe. Because our understanding of the Spirit that has brought this book into being, we realize that when we're reading it, we're reading God's word. And isn't it a great thing? I know one of the greatest arguments about the power of God's word, the authority of God's word, is just its power when we read it to change our lives and how it speaks to us day by day. And have you ever, I know you have, found yourself in your daily devotion time and you just thought, oh, Lord, you're just speaking directly to me today. And it's just a marvelous, wonderful thing. And on top of all of that, to know that if there's any question concerning truth and authority, that we can go and rest upon God's word. Your constitution as a church, which, you know, is looked at during this time of pastoral change, places the sole authority for truth in this book. So this is what we stand upon. So the consistent teaching of that book, of course, is part of our DNA. My last thought today from this thought of consistent Bible teaching and preaching is number three, we find Jesus in every part of God's word. We find Jesus in every part of God's word. If we want people to know Jesus, if we want people to discover Jesus, they need to have an exposure to the Word of God. The whole Bible is built around one central theme, Christ Himself. The Old Testament is the story of a nation from whom one man would come to redeem the entire world. And Rich, your men's group has been studying prophecy. How many prophecies are there in the Old Testament that Jesus has fulfilled in the new? Is it more than 12? Is it more than 50? Do you know, Steve, how many prophecies are fulfilled in the New Testament? 300? Yeah, that sounds right to me. And I know there's different scales on how you interpret the prophecy that's been fulfilled. But throughout the Old Testament, Jesus is revealed. Jesus said to the Pharisees, he said in John 5, verse 39, you study the scriptures diligently because you think that in them you have eternal life. And Jesus says, these are the very scriptures that testify about me, yet you refuse to come to me to have life. Jesus is just saying, if you would really read the book and allow the Spirit to speak, you would see me all through its pages. And then again, after the resurrection, when Jesus was on the road to Emmaus with several of the disciples, when they had not yet recognized him, Luke 24, 27 says that Jesus, and beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. So, you know, Jesus opening their eyes and showing them from all the way back to Moses, all the way through the prophets, how the scriptures were speaking about him. So we are going to be praying and we're going to be asking the Lord, Lord, send us a Bible preaching pastor and give that pulpit committee discernment to know during the interview process if we're getting something less than a guy or a girl that is going to give to us on a consistent basis your word coming to us day by day. Man's words don't count for anything. God's words count for everything. I can tell you as a pastor and as someone that's prepared messages for a long, long time, that I never take confidence in an illustration. I never take confidence in some wise insight that I think I may have discovered. Every single time that we're called upon to speak, I see God's word as these beautiful pillars of truth. And if a message has those beautiful pillars of truth, that's what a message stands on. All the other is filler, but it's those scripture passages of truth that are what God quickens by his Holy Spirit that brings about changed lives. So that is this first thought in our look at what do healthy churches do, and that is they offer consistent Bible teaching and preaching. So next week we're going to be looking at build community. And right now you are experiencing, have experienced here at the church, a wonderful sense of community. And one of the things that really has stood out to Cindy and I is just it's a multi-generational church. And you don't see everywhere multi-generational churches, but you have a multi-generational church. You have babies that have just been born. You have young people that have just been married. You've got young adults, you have young marrieds, you have middle-aged, you have early retirees, all the way up to those that I know that Robert recently passed away. How old was your dad, Camille? He would have turned 87 last week. So you've got the total age span. In fact, we had someone show up the other day that was 97 years old. Isn't that right? Andy something? So that is a beautiful thing as far as community. And you're doing something right to attract that broad of a group. So we're going to look at that next week on what does a healthy church do? They build community. And I'm not saying that you're not without room to improve, but may God and the Holy Spirit and his word show us how we can do even better, as we are seeking to be a healthy church. Well, we have just a few minutes left. I got sort of scolded today for letting you out too early the last time, but is there anyone else that would like to share concerning your experience of being in a church that had consistent biblical teaching and what a blessing it was to you?
With the 11, raised up his voice and declared to them Jesus, and the Holy Spirit filled the place.
And the Holy Spirit filled the place. Amen. Any others of you have a testimony of being a part of a healthy body and how the Word of God just played such an important role? Now, wait a minute. Who here came to faith in Faith Center in Eugene, Oregon? You guys came to faith. And you also, Camille, and I've forgotten the pastor's name. Roy Hicks, and did he preach the word? Camille, you're rolling your eyes. So we're not going to give you the mic. We're going to give Ann.
This was a long time ago. So I actually, when I got saved, there was not really an altar call. But the Holy Spirit was so heavy, I knew I wanted whatever it was that was there. And then Seth took me to church. That was like our second date. And then he explained with the word, what was going on. But I just knew there was something different there. So, Camille, if you were there longer than I was just off and on. So.
Okay, we have a few minutes left, but we still have time. If anyone else has something they'd like to share, give input on.
We were a part of a church that had great doctrine, but it lacked the other things that made for a healthy church. It didn't do the evangelism. There was no missions. There was, but the doctrine was incredible. And the fellowship was good. But without those other things, the church died, which it did. But anyway, that's kind of where I really appreciated that solid doctrine and meeting together with men that were solid in that area. It's critical, especially for men, I think.
Amen. And I know that there's quite a bit of discussion today about, you know, churches that flow with the Spirit, that are in tune with the Spirit, that are inviting the Holy Spirit to come, which I think we're going to see when we look at an expectation of God moving in power, and I think it was number 4. And then you also see churches that are very strong in the Word, solid doctrine, solid Bible teaching. God's Word is their guide. They check everything like the Bereans did against what God's Word says. And those are not have one but can't have the other. They don't exclude each other. But I think when you have a strong, biblically Word-oriented fellowship that is also an empowered fellowship that is welcoming of the moving and the power of the Holy Spirit, then you have a powerful combination when you get those two together, because the Spirit will be there to anoint the Word. And when the Word is there to direct and provide the foundation that is needed as the Spirit's moving, you just have a very powerful combination. And guess who wants to have the last word tonight?
I think what's really important, and when I look back on when I first came here, I felt the Word was strong, the teaching was solid, but to love God and love people the way you love God wasn't necessarily there. And I think that loving God and loving people is super important, and not becoming easily offended and forgiving quickly among your body is super important. And I didn't, you know, we have grown so much in the 20-something years I've been here. And I know it's God, and it's a lot of, you know, Jeremy being used by the Lord.
And that's a great testimony of just how this body has helped you. By the way, the Sieberts, if you haven't heard, did arrive in Norway. I wish I could say that they're not in quarantine, but at the present they are in quarantine. But they are, I was told by Ron, that they've been, forgive me Ron if it wasn't you, but that they all have Norwegian citizenship except Jeremy. But Jeremy does have a Norwegian equivalent of our Social Security. So I heard Jeremy was trying to argue with them, hey, wait a minute, we're citizens, you should let us just come in. So I keep praying for them. Rochelle said, you know, it's not all bad. They probably wouldn't be resting if they weren't put in quarantine. So
I just wanted to share, you know, one of the things I love about our Bible is current day we have Hebrew and Greek scholars, you know, that go back to the early original parchments, reading those manuscripts, double checking, making sure that the English Bibles we're reading is proper translations. And I love it that, you know, we hold that Bible in our lap and read it every day, or we hold that in our lap as the preacher is preaching, double checking, you know, okay, is he on track, or, you know, is this accurate? And we're not trusting the traditions of man or the traditions of a spiritual leader. We're trusting this Word of God. And I think it's beautiful how it can be tested. You know, we can go back to the Dead Sea Scrolls. We can go back way before the Dead Sea Scrolls were discovered and just see how authentic the scripture is and how, you know, just true it is. So I love that part about God's Word. It can be tested.
Amen. Well, I'd like to teach you one word tonight in Chinese, if I could, and that word is hallelujah. Do you know how to say hallelujah in Chinese? Hallelujah. Pastor Steve, would you close us in a word of prayer tonight?
Father, we thank you that you are the only one. There is no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. And we thank you, Father, in so many ways, in all ways. You are the first one. You are the number one. You are the way, the only truth, and the only life. And so, Lord, we want to keep you centered. And we want to rejoice with you. And we want to weep with you. We want to be honest with you. And we pray, Father, that you would move among us in such a powerful way that we can't resist touching somebody else's life with the Word of God. We thank you for your gospel, for it is the power of God unto salvation for those who believe. And Lord, thank you for giving us this wonderful hope that will never, never, never disappoint us, ever. In Jesus' name, amen.
We'll take a few moments just to say hello to each other, see how everybody's doing, and to fellowship. And if you could stay at least one more minute, then I won't get in trouble.